Thank you. Thank you all very much, most distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. We're indeed grateful that you have borne with us this far, and we still will crave your indulgence as we await the arrival of His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. We thank you all very much. But please permit me to specially recognize the presence of one of the great minds in Nigerian journalism, whose admonition and advisory led to the setting up of the Guardian newspapers. The distinguished gentleman has served Nigeria in quite a number of capacities, and he's honored us again this afternoon with his most revered presence. Join me as I specially recognize and welcome Aremo Segun Oshoba. And he's here along with the adorable wife, Mommy Bere Adeyinshola. We thank you very much, Mommy. We are grateful that you are here with us. Thank you very much. Permit me also to specially, very specially, recognize the spouse, adorable, dependable, most reliable, of the publisher of the Guardian newspaper, who has carried on from where the husband left the baton to her. Please join me in specially recognizing and welcoming Lady Maiden Alex Ibru. We thank you very much, Mommy. We are indeed thankful that you are here. We are thankful for this honor. From the clan of the Ibrus, I also have our own brother, who has been very supportive of what the Guardian has been doing these several seasons. Olorogun Oscar Ibru, thank you very much. We are indeed grateful. The son of the publisher, Toke Ibru, is also here. Thank you very much, Toke, for carrying on so very brilliantly with the flagship. I'll crave your indulgence further to specially recognize the chairman of the board of the Guardian Publications, Professor Omoli. We are indeed thankful that you are here, sir. Thank you very much for your distinguished presence. Quite a number of recognitions to be made, but permit me to also recognize especially one of our own. You may not have put up any cartoon illustrations at the Guardian. You may not have written any articles in the Guardian or gone out to report for the Guardian, but he has friends, and he continues to hold those friends high and dear because of his commitment to publishing in Nigeria, to growing minds and nurturing them in Nigeria. help me welcome Prince Unduka Obaigwena this day. Thank you, sir. And thank you for Arise News Television. May I also specially recognize and welcome a friend of the house, Chief Juke Burkout. Thank you very much. And so for all in color to what's going on, please don't bother to stress. No, it's okay. It's good. We understand. You know. Thank you very much, Chief Juke Burkout. We do have some other friends here, colleagues, senior colleagues, who have been a part of the flagship story and are still very proud to identify with it. At the very beginning, he was the pioneer editor and later became the chief operating officer. Permit me specially to recognize the one who gets to identify all those grammatical foibles that some of us are wont to throw out once in a while, inadvertently perhaps. The only one who gets cut out. Let's welcome, as we recognize, Mr. Ladi Bonwola, alias Lagbo. Also wish to specially recognize the presence of the photographer, the jazz enthusiast and drummer, the barber, the friend of quite a number, our own Sumi Smart Cole. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir. No, it's good. Thank you very much, Uncle Smart Cole. Let me also recognize my own uncle and special editor at the African Guardian then, Uncle Teddy Were, thank you very much. I'm also reliably informed that a very distinguished gentleman is always a delight to engage him in an interview session. He's been a part of the story right from the beginning when the flagship kicked off. His Excellency Ambassador Patrick Delecole is here with us. Thank you very much, sir. Okay. No, it's okay. We understand these things now. Some of us are also getting younger, so we know what it is to have supporting services. And indeed, His Excellency Ambassador Patrick Delecole, who is a pioneer consultant and was at Ibadan Grammar School with a publisher, so is a member of the family, more or less. Thank you very much, sir, for being a part of it today. We are indeed grateful that you could honor us with your distinguished presence. May I also recognize some of our friends and colleagues who have gone out to represent us very well in the political arena. I try to be careful here now, but it's okay. You know, whether we are dancing a little to the left or a little to the right, the center must hold. Distinguished Senator Ayogweze, thank you very much. He's been very instrumental to getting this entire program going, rallying members of the Guardian family from here and there to ensure that we keep the flagship flying. He's indeed the chairman of a special flagship trust fund that has been initiated by former staff members of the Guardian newspapers. We are indeed thankful, distinguished Senator Ayogu Eze. Thank you, sir. Another big uncle of ours, whose name reminds us of a decree, is also here in the house. When I mention his name, you will know the decree I'm talking about. Let's also recognize and welcome Uncle Tunde Thompson. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Well, we had another friend and colleague who also went into the House of Representatives. Honorable Abdul Oro is here. Thank you. Where are thou? Thank you. Thank you. He's waving so very well like they do. That makes it fantastic. We also wish to recognize the presence of, again, one of our own in a unique manner. Ms. Ayobe, thank you also for being a part of this process and for honoring us with your presence. Please, we would also try to recognize all of those who have come from far and near. I know that some of the governors have sent in their representatives. I want to believe that the Lagos State Commissioner for Information, Aaron Benga Motosho, is in the house. Thank you very much, sir. Do I cite him or are they waiting for protocols? We also have a representative of His Excellency, the Governor of Delta State, and the person of the Secretary to the State Government, Barrister Chiedu Ebie. Thank you very much, sir, for your presence this afternoon. There's a representative of the Sokoto State Governor here, ahead of His Excellency, the Governor, I'm told, Mr. Issa Galadima. Thank you also. Thank you. Thank you very much. He's the Honorable Commissioner of Information in Sokoto State, Mr. Issa Galadima. Thank you. The Ekiti State Governor, one of our own, Dr. John Kayode Fayemi, is also represented by Mr. Yinka Oyebode. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. The Enugu State Governor is ably represented by another one of our own, the Chief Press Secretary to His Excellency the Governor, Ifeanyi Gwanyi. His name is Mr. Chuks Ugwuoke. Thank you very much, Chuks. I've not seen you in a long while. Where is Chuks? Okay, all right, thank you. I'm told that instead is Mr. Samson Ezia, who is the Senior Special Assistant Media, a former staff of The Guardian. Samson, it's good to see you again. He's representing His Excellency, the Governor of Enugu State, Honorable Ifeanyi Ugwuanyi. Samson Ezia, where are you, please? Oh, okay, great. I've seen the red cap. Should I add Chief now? Where is Lolo? Thank you very much for honoring us with your presence. We'd also keep waiting, and we also crave your indulgence to bear with us a little while longer. If you know, His Excellency the Vice President is wearing two caps, and they are very golden caps, also a bit heavy, as the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. So some other ceremonies of state going on today, but since he has given us his word and his assurances, we know he will join us any moment now. So do bear with us. We'll roll on once His Excellency the Vice President steps in. At the point, we wish to invite a young performer, Effie. Oh, is it Effa? Oh, I'm sorry. Effa Onibata. Thank you.
Oh, Oh. Thank you.
Thank you very much, most distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. And while we're enjoying the wonderful performance by the Lady Efa Onibata, we also were honored by the distinguished presence of His Excellency, the former Governor of Cross River State of Nigeria, Mr. Donald Duke. We thank you very much for your presence here this afternoon. I know he's having a photo session in a moment, and we do recognize that you've come here to celebrate with us. And also a very special recognition for our own big uncle, the guardian, and he, yeah, was there right from the beginning when the guardian as a policy chose to poach from the universities. So he had to abandon theater and the theater arts and English department at Ife, the University of Ife, now Obafemi Awolowo University, to take up residency at Rutam House. And so till tomorrow, a lot of us regard him as our big uncle. There cannot be only one. Today he serves as the pro-chancellor of the same university where he nurtured minds very many years ago. Join me as I specially recognize and welcome Dr. Yemi Ogunbi. Thank you very much, sir, for your presence here today. Thank you, sir. There's only one shaft in Africa. Yeah, those who know, you know. Let's visit home at the Guardian as it is today. And specially recognize some members of the management team of the Guardian family. A director of the Guardian, Dr. Alex Thermopoulos. Thank you very much, sir, for your presence here. We are indeed grateful. Thank you for all the support you've been rendering this several seasons. Join me in recognizing and welcoming Mr. Martins Oloja. Thank you very much. Thank you, Martins. Martins has been offered commissionership over 5 times in Benue State. They thought that he was from Benue State. They didn't know that he's an Ilaje man from Ondo. And he, you know, politely declined. No, I'm not from Benue, you know. Or next time, if they offer you, I know some people that you can pass them on to. May I also recognize Professor Jide Jimo, who is of the School of Communications at the Lagos State University, and he's a visiting member of the editorial board of The Guardian. Thank you very much, sir. Elder Jacob Akindele is also a member of the editorial board of The Guardian. Professor Abigail Ogwezi in Sidika, former head of department mass communication at the University of Lagos and a member of the editorial board of The Guardian. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you. I know that if I go on trying to recognize everybody, we might not do it all. I do not know. Yeah, but part of the challenge I have, honestly, is this mask matter, where all of us are now looking like marauders, you know. Can't even recognize people anymore. But I know that I did see, I saw Iyabo Obaleke earlier. Yeah, and I have seen Rahim Adedoyin. I have seen Kingsley Osadolo, I've seen Fred Owawa, I've seen Abraham Ogbodo, I've seen Gabriel Mohimi, I've seen, they were wearing their masks, you know, but I was able to make out from their eyes. Tajuddin Abdurrahim, yes, is here, you know, and so many others. Please, you know, don't be very angry. I'll have to go around again and see whether I can recognize them. I thank you all for being a part of it. Thank you all very much. Thank you. We try to play it by the ear, but we know that the day is not getting any younger, and so we would try and skip some protocols while honoring those who are here and who have kept their presence very warm all this while. And so we'll go ahead and run with the program. I'm not the only one doing this, Sheyi. Don't go far, Sheyi. Come. Sheyi Adeyemo is my co-compere. My name is Ohi Alegbe. I was also at The Guardian some time ago. Thank you. So Sheyi and I would try and stir the affairs of state this afternoon. I thank you all very much. So would effect a slight structural adjustment on the program that we have here and run on to welcome all of us formally. And no other person can do that but Aaron Ukodie, be on standby to come welcome us formally. I can do it as much as you can do. So. Are you good to go? Yeah. All right. To Nigerians who had served at The Guardian, Shehun Ogusheitan and Aaron Ukodie put together this publication, and they are here to welcome us formally. Kunle Sonyaolu, editorial page editor of The Guardian. You are here as well, I'm told. Dr. Luke Onyekakea, a member of the editorial board, is here as well. Thank you very much. His Excellency, the Vice President, is on his way here, I'm told. But we think that we can speed up things a bit so that when he comes, we'll give full value to his presence by observing all the protocols. But at this point, join me as I welcome Mr. Aaron Ukodie, who made his mark as our communications correspondent those very years in the flagship of Nigerian journalism. Aaron Ukodie.
Good afternoon, distinguished guests who are here present. I will just go ahead and read the welcome address. Welcome remarks by Aaron Ukodie, co-author of The Making of a Nigerian Flagship, A Story of The Guardian. The process of writing the book that is about to be unveiled started sometime in September 2019. That was when Mr. Ogusheitan and I decided to document the story of The Guardian and our recollections of our time at The Guardian. The Guardian newsroom was an interesting place to work as a journalist between 1983 and 1993, the time frame which the book covered. Those of us who were there at the time as reporters were very competitive in generating stories. What mattered to us then were exclusive stories, and we jostled for whose story would make the lead copy. Rutham House was a bubbly place. I jostled for exclusive stories to hit The Guardian front page was vivacious. It was the only passion that stirred us. We enjoyed working there, even though that period recorded some sad occurrences. The friendships and the camaraderie were such that some of the men left the place with valuable gifts, jewels of inestimable values. I hope you understand that. The times we enjoyed at the Guardian couldn't have been possible without the foresight and the entrepreneurial disposition of our founding publisher, Mr. Alex Urimu Ibru, a man of noble character and calm disposition. It is in recognition of his sterling contribution to robust and unmatched journalism and commentary that we honor him today. His traditional white buba and shokoto and signature reticence were known to all. Interviewing about 16 of our bosses and some of our colleagues to gather materials for this book was not easy. But the strategy of pulling almost the key figures of that era into a digital platform made it possible for us to gather more materials, authenticate facts and narrations. It helped us to get our seniors and colleagues at The Guardian to buy into the project and support us. The results of their support is the inclusion of the personal reflections and recollections of 40 of them of our days during the time in the book, a section of the book that you would enjoy reading. My colleague Sheung, during the vote of thanks, would surely express our appreciations to those who helped us immensely to make this book possible. But I want to quickly mention upfront some of those who made this task easy for us, should memory and time fail Sheung to do justice to his task. You would read in the book how wonderful Mr. Ladi Bonola, the one we call Ladbone, and Kusa, I read that again. You would read in the book how wonderful Mr. Ladi Bonola and Kusa are in their chosen profession of journalism. They were our beacon in the newsroom. We cannot pay them for their assistance in helping us get materials for this book. Professor Onwuchika Jemi and Dr. Yemi Ogunbiji were ever supportive. So were Dr. Patrick Cole, Professor Jide Oluwaje Uton, Kingsley Osadolo, Suli Abu, and Emeka Izeze. I remember one certain day in the course of writing, I opened my mailbox. What I saw was a very valuable material from Larry Ndo. It helped us fill an important gap in our narration. In fact, all the 256 members of the When the Flagship led WhatsApp platform were marvelous. We couldn't have succeeded without them. Mr. Vice President, sir, we are greatly honored that you would find time to be here with us, knowing the many challenges of our time and how they occupy your attention daily. Today, I came to see your special assistant media, Pastor Laulu Akande, in Abuja to give him a letter inviting you to this event. I was only testing the biblical injunction that says, seek, you shall find, knock, and it shall be opened unto you, ask, and you shall receive. Now I know, even more so, that it works. The Vice President is on his way here. Welcome, sir. It is also not easy for governors to leave their stations at this moment in our nation's history when they daily are handling or thinking of how to handle the security challenges in their various states. We welcome the governors, the people who are representing them. Lagos State Governor, who is Binga Omotosho, who is one of our colleagues at The Guardian, is representing the governor of Lagos State. Delta State Governor is being represented by Barrister Chiedu AB and Commissioner for Information and Chief Press Secretary. I think traffic is delaying them. They will be here. They'll be here very soon. Sokoto Governor is represented by Commissioner of Information, Issa Galadanshi. Governor of Ekiti State is represented by Yinka Oyebode, Chief Press Secretary. Governor of Kwara State, I'm told, will be watching by Zoom, but is here represented by Rahim Adedoyin, who was also former Commissioner of Information and one of our ace reporters of The Guardian. In fact, me and him, we joined The Guardian the same month. Enugu State Governor Chuks Ugweku is here. Representing Enugu State Governor. And Now is the publisher of The Guardian. I will also say my publisher because we still relate to the guardian, Mrs. Maiden Ibru. I remember, you know, I told her that, look, madam, when I met her in her home, because she has a reflection in the book, too. When you get the book, you see what she wrote. And when I got to her house to interview and the courtesies and everything, when I left, I have to send her a text. I said, madam, I had a very wrong impression about you. I never knew you were so friendly and so approachable. You are like your husband. So, madam, I'm very happy the support you gave to us, accepting to write for the book, and very good read when you get the book. The chairman of the Flagship Trust Fund, Senator Ayogweze, you are also welcome. My colleague, I've said this. This is a welcome remark. So all the dignitaries and invited guests who have found time to honor this event, we welcome you and hope that when you buy the book, you will not be disappointed reading its content. May I please remind you that 20% of net income from proceeds of this book will be given to the Flagship Trust Fund, the creation of the members of the Flagship platform, which Senator Ayogu would speak about when he is given an opportunity to make a remark. God bless you and enrich your pockets, from which you would bless the book abundantly this day with your substance, which we believe is valuable in many ways. God bless you all. You are welcome.
Please let's put our hands together one more time for Mr. Aaron Okodia. Now, although I never worked in the Guardian, but I had the opportunity to regularly visit my uncle, Dr. Yemi Ogunbiyi, at the Guardian. So, of some sort, I'm a member of the family too. Not directly, but I was one of those who regularly would come and harass him for money at the Guardian at that time. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, without a doubt, one of the most potent qualities of a leader is to have a clear vision. And it is also critical that one puts a plan in place through which one will achieve that objective. It is so clear that 38 years the Guardian have remained the flagship of newspaper in Nigeria. I'd like to enjoin everyone to please put your hands together as we celebrate this very, very wonderful product that was put together by this great man. We can do better than that, please. In some way, I also publish, and I know that it is not easy to put a publication together, particularly in Nigeria. And so if one does it well and does it to a point where in 1998, the New York Times clearly described and defined the Guardian as Nigeria's most respected newspaper, I think is something that we ought to celebrate. So now a documentary has been put together where a lot of testimonies and a lot of attributes were given. I would just want to enjoin every one of us to just sit back and watch this documentary, and I'm very assured that you will see one of the great things that the founder did. The documentary, please.
Alexander Uruemu Ibru One of the most creative and endearing entrepreneurs of this generation was no ordinary man, a patriotic Nigerian, corporate enigma, compassionate humanitarian, and national icon. He was popularly known as the publisher who shaped and influenced high-quality journalism and professionalism. He founded many companies, the most notable being The Guardian newspaper, which he started with Stanley Makaber in 1983 and has grown to become one of the most respected newspapers in the country. Indeed, the history of newspaper publishing in Nigeria would not be complete without the name Alexander Oruemu. Born into the family of Chief Ekpete and Janet Omotogo Ibru on March 1, 1945 in Lagos, Sir Alexander Oruemu Ibru, the youngest brother of the business mogul and founder of the Ibru organization, attended Yaba Methodist Primary School from 1951 to 1957, Ibadan Grammar School from 1958 to 1960, Igbobi College, Lagos from 1960 to 1963, and the University of Trent, formerly Trent Polytechnic, from 1967 to 1970, where he studied business economics. Barely out of Trent Polytechnic, Alex launched out on a journey that would certify him as one of the most successful young businessmen in the country. At just 25 in 1970, he founded Rutem Motors, a car dealership company that traded in some of the most notable car brands of that era. 13 years later, and just before he started The Guardian, he had become a wealthy 38-year-old with considerable interests in a range of other businesses, from insurance, hospitality, to advertising. Hungry for more, Sir Alex Ibru met with some of Nigeria's brightest newspaper men, Stanley Makaber of the Daily Times of Nigeria, Dele Cole and Segun Oshoba, formerly of the Nigerian Herald, and together they started what is today known as the flagship of Nigerian journalism in 1983. Established to present balanced coverage of events and promote the best interests of Nigeria and Africa in the most intellectual manner, it adopted a motto, Conscience Nurtured by Truth, inspired by the late Othman Danfodio saying, "The Guardian's primary commitment since inception has been to maintain the integrity and sovereignty of the Federation of Nigeria, and beyond that, sustain the unity and sovereignty of Africa." Indeed, he was said to have set up the newspaper out of a desire to stimulate intellectual discussions that will shape Nigeria and Africa's development. In pursuit of his aim and objectives of uncovering truths and the battle for freedom and democracy in an era of corrupt and repressive military regimes in Nigeria and Africa at large, the late Sir Alex Ibru and his eminent team at The Guardian were joint heroes of revolutionary uprising. He was a genuine nationalist who believed that Nigeria had a manifest destiny to provide good leadership for Africa and the world. He was also a consummate advocate of Africa's liberation and renaissance. He strongly believed in Africanism and gave unrelenting support to the cause of democracy and correctly stigmatized the military regime as a usurper. Aside from the late Sir Alex Ibru's managerial genius, which played a role in the paper's revenue, advertising, patronage, and readership, another factor that ensured the success of The Guardian was the professional and intellectual elan of the editorial team. There was already a solid foundation to build on. Sir Alex Ibru fortified it with learned people to match the credentials of some of the best newspapers in the world. The mix consisted of a fine blend of academics, media professionals, and those with distinguished careers in government and business. Alexander Oruemu Ibru, one of the most creative and endearing entrepreneurs of this generation, was no ordinary man. A patriotic Nigerian, corporate enigma, compassionate humanitarian, and national icon, he was popularly known as the publisher who shaped and influenced high-quality journalism and professionalism. He founded many companies, the most notable being The Guardian newspaper, which he started with Stanley Makaber in 1983 and has grown to become one of the most respected newspapers in the country. Indeed, the history of newspaper publishing in Nigeria would not be complete without the name Alexander Oruemu. Born into the family of Chief Ekpete and Janet Omotogo Ibru on March 1, 1945 in Lagos, Sir Alexander Oruemu Ibru, the youngest brother of the business mogul and founder of the Ibru organization, attended Yaba Methodist Primary School from 1951 to 1957, Ibadan Grammar School from 1958 to 1960, Igobe College, Lagos from 1960 to 1963, and the University of Trent, formerly Trent Polytechnic, from 1967 to 1970, where he studied business economics. Barely out of Trent Polytechnic, Alex launched out on a journey that would certify him as one of the most successful young businessmen in the country. At just 25, in 1970, he founded Rutem Motors, a car dealership company that traded in some of the most notable car brands of that era. 13 years later, and just before he started The Guardian, he had become a wealthy 38-year-old with considerable interests in a range of other businesses, from insurance, hospitality, to advertising. Hungry for more, Sir Alex Ibru met with some of Nigeria's brightest newspaper men, Stanley Makabo of the Daily Times of Nigeria, Dele Cole and Segun Oshoba, formerly of the Nigerian Herald, and together they started what is today known as the flagship of Nigerian journalism in 1983. Established to present balanced coverage of events and promote the best interests of Nigeria and Africa in the most intellectual manner, it adopted a motto, Conscience Nurtured by Truth, inspired by the late Othman Danfodio saying, "The Guardian's primary commitment since inception has been to maintain the integrity and sovereignty of the Federation of Nigeria, and beyond that, sustain the unity and sovereignty of Africa." Indeed, he was said to have set up the newspaper out of a desire to stimulate intellectual discussions that will shape Nigeria and Africa's development. In pursuit of his aim and objectives of uncovering truths and the battle for freedom and democracy in an era of corrupt and repressive military regimes in Nigeria and Africa at large, the late Sir Alex Ibru and his eminent team at The Guardian were joint heroes of revolutionary uprising. He was a genuine nationalist who believed that Nigeria had a manifest destiny to provide good leadership for Africa and the world. He was also a consummate advocate of Africa's liberation and renaissance. He strongly believed in Africanism and gave unrelenting support to the cause of democracy and correctly stigmatized the military regime as a usurper. Aside from the late Sir Alex Ibru's managerial genius, which played a role in the paper's revenue, advertising, patronage, and readership, another factor that ensured the success of The Guardian was the professional and intellectual elan of the editorial team. There was already a solid foundation to build on. Sir Alex Ibru fortified it with learned people to match the credentials of some of the best newspapers in the world. The mix consisted of a fine blend of academics, media professionals, and those with distinguished careers in government and business. Till today, that philosophy has remained with the title. Indeed, the success of The Guardian made it clear that there was an appetite for high-quality journalism in Nigeria. 10 years after he passed, and 38 years after pioneering high-quality journalism in Nigeria with thoughtful editorial content, The Guardian has continued to impact positively on its readers, clients, and society. The vision birthed by Sir Alex Ibru, by providing reliable content that promotes knowledge, political stability, and economic prosperity. With the firm leadership of his adorable and amiable wife, Lady Maiden Ibru, the vision of the late founder has evolved into a large multimedia enterprise with interests in films, music, digital television, and other productions in order to remain relevant in an ever-changing world. Sir Alex Ibru was a man whose weight was measured in gold. His legacy will remain etched in the sands of time as an epitome of excellence, intellectualism, and the pursuit of liberty for all.
Thank you all very much. We apologize about that break in transmission because of a technical hitch. I do hope that we enjoyed the story of the publisher of The Guardian, Mr. Alex Ibru. There was a vehicle that we even bugged him about. I was somewhere parked at the back. You remember? And he would go there every morning and crank it. But he never rode it. And then we were wondering why he always dutifully did that. And so Short and Sharp came on it and bugged him. We thought that he would take it in bad faith, but you know, he also laughed about it, and we all enjoyed the joke that came with it. A great mind indeed. No wonder the flagship remains the flagship of Nigerian journalism. Thank you all, most distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. We are informed that any moment now, His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, will be with us. Another distinguished guest that we are expecting. But meanwhile, permit me to recognize some old guardian hands who have gone on to do so many other things since then. Is now responsible for the Dame Awards. And in Aaron Ukudi's remarks a while ago, he did mention his name because he was one of the formidable hands in the newsroom. Mr. Lanre Dowu, thank you very much, sir. We are happy that you are here with us. Thank you. May we also recognize our own Taiwo Obe. Thank you very much. We almost did not recognize him. He's wearing a cap similar to mine. And Taiwo Obe, Taijo Wanukabe, etc., etc., etc. But the production desk, the sub desk, enjoyed the fine penmanship of Taiwo Obe and his colleagues. We thank you very much. Gbemiga Ogunleye is here as well. Thank you. We welcome you. Gbemiga, I thought I cited you somewhere. May I also recognize and welcome the Chief Operating Officer, Editor-in-Chief? Yeah. Benga Adefaye is in the house. We embraced barring COVID protocols a while ago. Thank you, Benga Adefaye of the Vanguard. The Managing Director of the Sun Newspapers, Mr. Onwara Uke, is also in the house. Onwara, yeah, okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. We're indeed grateful that you joined us. We'll go back home to the Guardian as is today. The General Manager, Corporate and Legal Services of the Guardian, Efituri Ojona, thank you. We are happy that you are here with us. Mr. Kazim Oladunyi, General Manager, Business Operations, thank you also. Mr. Charles Adaramuye, Commercial Press Manager, thank you also very much. We are very happy that you are keeping the flagship flag flying. Thank you. We do not intend to invite our chairman to speak to us until His Excellency the Vice President arrives, because it's only very necessary that that is done. So what we intend to do before, as we expect the arrival of His Excellency the Vice President, and also to recognize our colleagues from Delta State representing His Excellency Senator Dr. Ifeanyi Okonwa, the Secretary to Government of, excuse me, yeah, let me get the name right. Okay, yeah. He's the Secretary to the State Government of Delta State of Nigeria. He joined us while we were at this podium a while ago. Barrister Chiedu Ebie, thank you very much, sir. You are most welcome from Delta State of Nigeria. I think he's accompanied by the Honorable Commissioner for Information, Delta State, Charles Aniagu. There's a middle name. We'll continue. But one of us as well, a fantastic gentleman who handles who manages the reputation of His Excellency the Governor and the people of Delta State. We were going to effect a slight structural adjustment on the program and see whether we could invite some of the representatives of the state governors to give their goodwill messages while expecting the vice president. And I think we wish to first recognize from Sokoto State, representing His Excellency, the governor of Sokoto State, Right Honorable Aminu Tambuwal, the Honorable Commissioner for Information in Sokoto State, Mr. Issa Galadanchi. I had said Galadima before, now I apologize, Galadanchi. Please let's welcome him for his goodwill and message. Thank you very much. Thank you.
His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Chief Yemi Osinbajo, our dear father, Dr. Shogun Oshoba, the Ibru family, I stand on all other protocols as duly observed. I've been asked by His Excellency, the Governor of Sokoto State, Right Honorable Aminu Aziz Tambuwal, to stand in here for him and convey his goodwill to the members of the family of the Guardian newspaper and the Ibru family. Accordingly, he has asked me to congratulate the authors of the book, The Flagship of Nigerian Journalism. He too being part of his life, he has been participating in some journalistic activities at a younger age after finishing his university degree. According to what he said, I should tell the people here is that journalism, like teaching, is a very blessed profession. However, the proverbial saying of the teacher's reward is a heaven. The reward of a journalist is not known to be anywhere. So it is more or less that the journalist who do his work right takes the reward in the heaven, because mostly teachers get their rewards here. They produce big men, big businessmen who patronize them even here in the world. So what we are doing here today is celebrating journalism and people who play a key role in journalism in Nigerian society. By so doing this, we are encouraging people to embrace the art of journalism and make it look as professional as it is, not as it is being conducted in these days. Because of the advent of ICT and other social media structure, you find that everyone can claim to be a journalist. Journalism has ethics. It is a profession. It has its own teachings. So these people who are trying to make these recollections are contributing to the advancement of journalism as we know it. And on behalf of the government and people of Sokoto State, I once again congratulate the authors and the family of the Guardian. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you very much, Mr. Galadanchi, for the goodwill message. We'll hop over to Enugu State and invite the representative of His Excellency, Ifeanyi Ogunwanyi, by one of our own, at the Guardian, Chief Samson is here for the goodwill message from Enugu State. Samson, thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. I've been sent here by my boss, the Executive Governor of Enugu State, Right Honorable Dr. Ifeanyi Ugwuanyi, to represent him here today at this very important occasion of the book launch of the flagship of the Guardian newspaper. I'm not only the aide of the governor, I still remain a staff of the Guardian newspaper, where I was groomed. And I'm on the leave of absence currently, serving in Enugu State as senior special assistant to the governor. So the governor will have been here today, but because of the tight schedules, you know the situation in the country today, he insisted that I have to be here to represent him. He is very, told me that I use this opportunity to congratulate the Guardian newspaper, especially the founding fathers of the Guardian newspaper, and those who made the newspaper tick. I'm happy to be here today, because there are people I don't know before, I've heard about them passing through Guardian, and I didn't meet them in Guardian, but I've seen them today, and I've known what they have contributed in making Guardian what it is today. On behalf of the good people of Enugu State and my boss, the governor of Enugu State, we congratulate the Guardian newspaper, the publisher, and the management of the Guardian newspaper for sustaining the legacy and sustaining the developmental journalism of the Guardian newspaper. Guardian newspaper is known for being a very pragmatic newspaper. It's known for being a factual newspaper. And it is not easy to continue to sustain and maintain that standard. Guardian is the flagship. For more than 3 decades now, they are still standing high in the media industry. Congratulations once more. And the governor said that he is very happy with what Guardian newspaper is doing, and is encouraging them to continue to sustain what they are doing, and ensure that they continue to be the newspaper many Nigerians and the world respect so much for what they have. Thank you very much. We'll still be there for you people and continue to partner with you to move the country forward and to move our state forward. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Samson. It's been wonderful. It's a great reunion for most of us. Permit me to quickly recognize the presence of one of our own who made his mark on the education beat. I'm not too sure that since he covered the education beat for The Guardian, we've had such remarkable success with the coverage of that beat. I think most of the reports these days are on ASU and ASU strike, which is not as challenging as digging deep and getting out the story. Please join me in recognizing and welcoming Dr. Godi Nadi, MNI. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for being a part of it. We'll hop over to Ekiti State. Today we are hopping over to Ekiti State to invite Mr. Yinka Oyebode, who is representing His Excellency the Governor, Dr. John Kayode Fayemi, who is indeed one of us. Please, you're most welcome. Thank you.
Good afternoon, gentlemen and ladies. All other excellencies were represented here by their various representatives. My name is Yinka Oyebode, and I'm standing in for the Governor of Ekiti State, Dr. Kayode Fayemi, who, interestingly, is also a product of the flagship, the Guardian family. He is unavoidably absent today because he has to attend to some other pressing issues back home and at the Federal Capital Territory. He has asked me to come here to bring his good wishes and to particularly say that he remains ever so grateful that he passed through the flagship family. And I believe that one of the guiding principles of Mr. Governor today are the principles that are guiding the Guardian, which he picked up while he had a stint there as a reporter back then. He has asked us to wish us well, especially to congratulate the writers of the book and also the management and staff of the Guardian newspapers. Wish you as well, and he looks forward to more rewarding relationship with the Guardian family. Thank you very much and congratulations.
Be outstanding to welcome the arrival of His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo. Please, while we remain standing, we have the national anthem. I'm informed that His Excellency, the Vice President, has instructed that we should not render the national anthem. Well, some persons have protested and said we should render it by singing it if we will not play it on it. Please, Mr. Vice President, sir, please. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Before we resume our seats, may I also crave your indulgence. We wish to commit this event again into the able and capable hands of God Almighty by reciting the second stanza of the national anthem. And it's on the screen. We can recite, please. O God of creation, direct our noble course, guide our leaders right, help our youth the truth to know, in love and honesty to grow, and living just and true, great lofty heights attain, to build a nation where peace and justice reigns. So help us God. Amen. Thank you very much. We may resume our seats. Thank you, most distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Your Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, GCON, we thank you for honoring us with your distinguished presence. We are aware of your very busy schedule, and we had said that we must obey all protocols since you have graciously joined us here. Thank you very much, sir, and you're most welcome. We'll go on with the rest of the program, as we have the special privilege and pleasure to invite the chairman of this event, His Excellency, the former governor of Ogun State of Nigeria, a great mind and a doyen of Nigerian journalism, who helped to midwife the birth of the Guardian newspapers. Please join me as I specially invite and welcome Aremo Olusegun Oshoba. Let's put our hands together for him.
The Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and a man who is a good friend of the media, I welcome you, Mr. Vice President. The publishers of the Guardian, Lady Maiden Alex Ibru, Mr. Vice President, you've come a long way, and I will not bore you with protocol. Everybody else here, they've all been recognized. I therefore stand on the recognition that have been done by the Director of Program. Mr. Vice President, I want to thank you for honoring us today. I shouldn't be the chairman. I'm one of those celebrating the event of today, because Alex and I, about 40 years ago, started the idea of Guardian about two houses away from here. It's now the office of Ororogun Ibru. Louis Solomon was where he was staying, and I was in Herald. And Alex had already been in love with we journalists, even though he and I grew up together, right from Yaba. And he had shown interest in journalism. And there, at Louis Solomon, we discussed the idea of starting a newspaper. And when I left the Herald, we registered a paper called The Voice. We were to start with an evening paper, because at that time there was so much traffic in Lagos, and we thought people sitting in the traffic who want something to while away the time. It was not the age of WhatsApp or email. And his own idea was to start a newspaper that would be deep, intellectual in approach, and still be readable to the ordinary people. But unfortunately, time, we were taking time because he did not want to start because he wanted the endorsement and approval of the matri- the patriarch of the family, Ololugun Michael Ibru. And that took a long time coming. So I went to sketch. In between, the whole thing started again. And by this time, his senior in Ibadan Grammar School, whom he respects a lot, he was a fag to Dr. Dele Cole, retired from Dele Times, and Dr. Dele Cole then took it up from there. Of course, Dr. Cole is the father of intellectual journalism in Nigeria. Before Dr. Cole came into the scene, there was nothing like editorial board. People write editorial in different newspaper. In fact, Jack Hunde was the only editorial writer in the Tribune, and his editorial was no government could ignore Jack Hunde in those debates. Dr. Dele Cole came in, brought in the likes of Stanley Makebu, Dele Giwanko, and created the intellectual wing of the media in this country. And so Alex picked on his senior to now join him, and I was working with the entire team from sketch. Fortunately, Chief Bola Ige, Chief BC Onabanjo, approved that I should still remain on the board of the Guardian, even though I was the managing director of the sketch. And that was the relationship. I remember 25 years ago, when we celebrated the 25th anniversary of the Guardian in this same premises, I was reminding Alex that as a mistake, he was celebrating the anniversary of the Guardian going daily. And I told him that the back date of Guardian was February 27. When we printed the first Guardian, it was a weekly Guardian. We printed it in the daily sketch. It was not the time of cutthroat competition. You'll be shocked that a competitor like Sketch is printing a new newspaper for another paper in Ibadan. And again, I got the clearance of my governors to do the same. So what the Guardian is celebrating lately is the day Guardian went daily. You don't celebrate your naming ceremony as a back date. It's the day you are born that you celebrate. I've been discussing that with Mrs. Publisher, Madam Maiden, Lady Maiden Ibru. Now, why was it that the daily was delayed? Well, his advisor then, Pius Anyon, ordered 6 units of printing press with one folder. What you call folder is a folder like this, and you have unit, and the paper will run through the unit into the folder and come out. When I heard of this, I went to Alex, I said, you are wrong. Please change the configuration to 2 folders and 3 units each. So you have 2 folders like this, 3 units here, 3 units here. So if you are printing 16 newspaper, 8 pages, the folder, the unit here will go into that folder. If you are going to print a 40 page, the folders on the left and on the right, the unit on the left and right will come into one folder. That was what delayed. So that advice, one, gives you 2 printing machines. In the event that you have problem with one, having 2 folders, you use the other. In the event you want to print bumper paper, all the 6 units will go into one folder. That was what delayed the starting of the Guardian in the Guardian premises, and we had to be printing for them in sketch and at no cost other than him providing the newsprint. So I want to correct that impression. Secondly, he told me he wanted a highly professional and a highly intellectual. Well, Dele Cole has settled the intellectual side. It's now left for me to now settle the professional side. I had worked with Lade Bonola, and Lade Bonola can be a nuisance. I was deputy editor of the Sunday. He was my chief sub-editor. And Ladie will edit a paper, semicolon, comma, the dash, this, grammar, English. And when it's getting late, I will almost slap him and just take everything off to the production room. He was too meticulous, and he wrote a column, his column called That Bone then, was critical of the writings in the newspaper. Every week he would review. I said, even if he produced the best newspaper, if it does not come out at 6 in the morning, it's worthless. So I knew that, one, Lade was professional, two, very deep, and that's why he's a great man. So I nominated him as the editor of the Guardian newspaper to compliment the intellectuals that Dileko was bringing in Stanley Makebu and Co. And that was how we combined. And Guardian now became a paper that will write the news and now research, beef it up, give it the background information and commentary. It was the first newspaper in Nigeria that does not just write news. It will write the news, analyze the news, give the background to the news, and make commentary on the news. And that was what made Guardian the best of its time. And Dileko and I have been discussing that we should meet the Maiden Alex Ibru to make sure that that standard of writing in-depth news is kept. And I'm happy the editorial board, it's one thing with Alex is that he respects seniors, he respects friends, he respects intellectualism. And when he was promised the editorial board, you won't believe the likes of the former secretary of the late federal government, Makama Abida, Sheu Musa, T.Y. Danjuma, high professional intellectual, why in the editorial board of the Guardian at the inception. So you can see the capacity and capability of Mr. Alex Ibru. One good thing about him is that he never interfered with the professionals in the Guardian. He never dictated to columnists. Even where he disagreed with them, he tolerated what they were writing. And today, I'm happy that the family is here, the friends are here, old Guardian are here. I want to thank the two writers who found it fit to put this thing together. The unfortunate thing in Nigeria is that we don't write. Jack Onde died, in spite of my pressure for over 30, 40 years to write, he didn't write. And the history of NUJ, the history of the Guild of Editors, the history of the National Newspaper Proprietors Association, the history of the NIG, of which Jack Onde was key player and founder of all these institutions for our profession, he did not write. He had a whole room full of files. If you want files on every of these institutions, you'll find it in Jack Onde's library. But he failed to write. It hurts me. So for those of you who have written this today, I want to thank you, which you have the history of the Guardian, and for the memory of Alex, a great man, a young man, a man of idea, a man of intellectual capacity, who respects the opinion of other people, who loves people of better intellectual standing, who respect professionals. May his memory continue to go on forever and ever. Thank you.
I want to believe that His Excellency Aremo Segun Oshoba does deserve a much more resounding applause. I only remarked that he joined in midwife in the birth. He was responsible more or less, for the birth of the Guardian newspaper. We thank you very much, sir, for honoring us with your presence today and for taking us down memory lane. We are indeed grateful. We again quickly speed up the program because the day is getting younger, and so we would juggle the program somewhat. Would play back the documentary again for the benefit of our guests and special guests of honor who have just come. But before then, our co-host is Delta State. And His Excellency the Governor is unable to be here because of other exigencies of state duty, but is ably and capably represented by Barrister Chiedu ABA. We wish to invite you, sir, the Secretary to the Government, Secretary to the State Government, Delta State of Nigeria, co-host of this event, for a goodwill message. Thank you very much.
Your Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Mr. Chairman, with your kind permission, may I adopt the protocols already established by the previous speakers. I stand here this afternoon on behalf of the Governor of Delta State, Senator Dr. Ifeanyi Okorwa, who had hoped to be personally present at this special occasion to celebrate with the Guardian family. He asked that I convey his regrets and profound regards and best wishes the organizers of this event. 38 years ago, The Guardian made a grand entry into the newspaper industry with a bold claim as the flagship of the Nigerian print media. The newspaper captured public attention with its in-depth reporting, rich content, intellectual flavor, and novel approach to print journalism. I still vividly recall the fateful day on the 27th of February 1983 when The Guardian made its debut. From its first corporate statement and the collection of names on the masthead, it was clear that the newspaper was destined to revolutionize the Nigerian media. Mr. Chairman has already highlighted some of those individuals, but some others include Alade, the inimitable columnist, Chimwezi, the radical political commentator, Dr. Omuchekwa Jemi, the pioneer editorial page editor, Eddie Iro, the novelist, Dr. Femi Osofisa, a renowned playwright, Sonala Olumese, an exciting young columnist, and Femi Kusa, a hard-nosed newsman, as assistant editor. It was indeed a unique assemblage of highly skilled professionals, managers, and men of scholarship. The Guardian began as, and still is, a carefully packaged product with specialized offerings targeted primarily at thinkers, decision makers in government, and leaders in business, finance, culture, and the professions. The Guardian's entry into the newspaper market was as refreshing as it was uplifting. Today, as we celebrate the making of the Nigerian flagship, the broad consensus is that The Guardian has lived up to its claim. The Guardian changed the tradition of shouting headlines cast in 72 points and 5 paragraphs to a subdued headline and rich content. It formalized the concept of the editorial board and gave primacy to the editorial as the reasoned voice of the newspaper. It changed the narrative from sensationalism to serious and interpretative reporting and brought intellectualism to the media scene. It also entrenched the tradition of specialization and separate departments in the newspaper. The late Mr. Alex Ibru, the founder, deserves a prime place in the Media Hall of Fame for his vision, courage, and tenacity. Prior to the coming of the flagship, the newspaper industry was generally seen more as a social service than a profitable enterprise that it should be. It was a remarkable display of chutzpah, a trait for which we Deltans are known for. And for a private investor like Mr. Alex Ibru to launch into the harsh terrain of newspaper publishing. His business acumen soon changed the narrative, and The Guardian became a model for other newspapers in terms of professionalism, excellent market segmentation, sound management, economic viability, and sustainability. Even more remarkable is that The Guardian overcame official government persecution, intimidation, closure, harassment, and imprisonment of its staff. To have survived these adversities and continue to thrive is a testament to the solid foundation on which the newspaper was built and the resourcefulness and tenacity of the brains behind it. To Lady Maiden Alex Ibru, Madam, we salute you for keeping the vision alive and sustaining the tradition of excellence and good corporate governance. I also recognize and appreciate all the staff, editorial and non-editorial, past and present, as well as those who have in one way or the other contributed to The Guardian's remarkable success story. My prayer is that the newspaper will continue to grow, break new grounds, and extend the frontiers of print journalism in Nigeria. Thank you very much for your attention, and God bless us all.
Your Excellency the Vice President, Your Excellency the Chairman, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, what brought us here is the publication that two young minds put together, Seun Ogunseyita and Aaron Okodie. I wish to crave your indulgence as I invite one of our own to give a brief peek into the publication with a review. A former editor of the Guardian newspaper, in fact, immediate past editor of the Guardian newspaper, Mr. Abraham Ogbodo. Please step forth for the book review, please. Thank you.
Yes. Good afternoon, everybody. The best way is to stand on the established protocol. If we are sitting, I will sit on the established protocol. But in introducing the reviewer, the MC did not capture it well. I'm actually not the reviewer. I am just to read the review. The review of this book was done by one of us two, Professor Abiodun Adeniyi. But for reasons he could not put under control, he's not here now, and he has asked me to do the review. So I'm going to do it just to read it, not that I did the review myself. I want to obey what he has said. And so, here is the review. The Making of the Nigerian Flagship is a Story of the Guardian. A review by Abiodun Adeniyi. The Making of the Nigerian Flagship, a Story of the Guardian, is an expository gem revealing the significant history of the Guardian newspapers 38 years after its establishment. Co-written by two of the newspaper's pioneer journalists, Aaron Okodi and Oluwaseun Ogunseyitan. The book is a brilliant compromise between an edited work, pulling together a galaxy of writers, and a work where authors are essentially original. This is because of its expansive aggregation of sources and ideas and their simultaneous ability to synthesize narratives in an ingenious way. The book is an attempt at constructing the evolution of an institution from a periodized standpoint and slowly and surely transporting the reader to a presence where actors in the evolution story are still actors in contemporary discourse of journalism and the pathways to its future. So, in other words, it's like bringing ancient and modern together. It is systematically in four unequal sections. Section one comprises four chapters entitled Two Dreams, One Fulfilled, The Structure, The Building, A Unique Team, and Fierce Battle for Space and Deflation. This section is a penetrating insight into the birth of the Guardian from the time of envisioning. It is gripping account of not just the experimental prowess of the famed Ibru brothers, evening out in the exemplification of Alex Ibru as eventual publisher, but also the specific roles played by media legends and intellectuals like Chief Olusegun Oshoba, he was here a while ago, Dr. Patrick Cole, yes, he's sitting amongst you, Dr. Stanley Makebu, may his soul rest in perfect peace, and Baba, Mr. Lagbo Bonola, Mr. Femi Kusa, Professor Onwuchika Jami, Mr. Nick Iduwe, Dr. Yemi Ogunbiyi, and many important others. The book reveals the role of the effervescent lady made in Ibru, my madam for life. Far beyond the traditional notion of a woman being behind a successful man to a woman being in front of a successful man. A round of applause, I think. This is for her living room defense of the serene, subdued, and sober headline that the Guardian opted for, amongst other advocacies. This session tells us more. How did the name The Guardian come about? How should the structure be modeled? And then the theme, what should it compose of? It went further to unveil reasons behind the paper's elite orientation, flowing from the high stake learnings of many of its pioneers, and to their interest in piercing through weakness of existing publications for a niche. What was more, they expressed the paper's belief in the elasticity of words, in the pulse of letters, and the infinite elegance of sumptuous prose. These are compulsory tools the founders fancied in situating the everyday essence of the society. Section 2 is longer with 9 chapters and with reflective interpretations. It began with a focus on that page of the Guardian which was not just a marketplace of ideas but a platform for the production of knowledge. They described the opinion and editorial page as deliberate, emanating from minds ready to make an academy from newspapering. Yes, we are talking of the editorial and opinion pages of the Guardian. That page was conceived as a soil for the germination of thoughts and more thoughts, eventually becoming a reference point to be studied and not just read. The co-authors tell us all about this, leading to chapters on strokes of wit and sense, and that on the catchy intros and headlines. What more do you expect with the level of erudition unsung at the Guardian, if not wit, wisdom, sense, sensitivities, and perspectives? And then see the news reporting orientation, where the authors are also elaborate. The Guardian introductions and headlines were a delight, according to the writers. Figuratively silent, soft, and sometimes surprisingly sedated, the headlines are suspensive. They prick the imagination, holding it still for an obligatory interest in the details and there an addition. That is very true. If you know the Guardian, writing an intro in the Guardian is about all the work. If a reporter can get an intro right, then the story is finished. In their original, in their occasional conversational prose, Aaron and Oluwaseun were generous with evidence, showing the preference for exclusive stories, a hallmark of the Guardian, and in how the paper delivered its feature stories with depth, spiced with dazzling and dazzling prose. Soon becoming interactional in their narratives, the authors closed the second section with the Guardian skybound outlook, from interviews with world leaders, a pan-African disposition, and the highlight of another pioneering effort with a focus on the Guardian literary series. I guess Dr. Yemi Ogunbiyi is here. That literary series was another masterstroke, as it tallies with an audience testing for specific exposition on the literati and the issues around them. The issues were more of matters of the mind and how the places and spaces of existence are created in thoughts it imparted, according to the twin writers. Section 3 equally has nine chapters and is concerned about the content and character of practitioners, the ethical flavor of the Guardian journalist, and the commitment to moral uprightness, beside an overarching standard that is speak and span. Yes, when we talk of ethical uprightness, until you are outside the Guardian, you will not really understand. You know, I once worked in government, and I was a spokesman. Anytime there was a report about my organization, the writers would have formed their opinion. They knew what they wanted to write, and they would just call me. Okay, what do you say about this? And I would tell them. Then they would take what they want to take and then report it. Once I was quoted out of context, that is the normal thing, and I was called before a board. What happened? Why did you say this? I said, this is not what I said. This is the full details, but this is what the reporter chose to take, because that was what served the purpose of the reporter. So that is the ethical uprightness. In a major chapter, the section veered to accommodating the experiences of 41 former journalists, comprising a cream of star writers and reporters like Professor Femi Osofinsan and Godwin Sogolo. Senator Ayogu Eze is here with us. Honorable Abdul Oro is also here with us, and a parcel of other professionals. For a moment, the contributors complemented the co-authors in compelling chronicles and a revitalization of the days of yore. That unit slowed to a conclusion with an account of some challenges. First, with the law, via arrest, detentions, trials, and convictions, like the case of Mrs. Tunde Thompson and Nduka Irabo. I think Oga Thompson is here with us. And then death in the house, like the sad story of Chris Imodibe. May his soul rest in perfect peace. In finishing the section, the authors remind us of the crisis of censorship and of repression. They tell us about the tension between press and power, between the right to know and the machinations against it, and between knowledge and ignorance. And then into the last section they come with six chapters, where they explore the philosophies of faith, the place of money and revenue, and the importance of purpose over power. In that segment, the authors are complete with details of the body and soul of a newspaper, its shaping and shared experiences in the rational spaces of reporting and analysis. But see, did they get it all right? Ordinarily impossible. On page 4 of my copy, the authors talk about come with us, while they also use the word banging out their stories on page 35. There are many more of these journalists or a cash-in on journalism license. With this, they detour from the formal language of communication in what they can create some ambivalence. The pluralization of style in rendition and the assemblage of data could also send different messages in the bid to appeal to a differentiated audience. Regardless, here we have a book straddling the borders of academic depth, a general interest read, empowered by a pack of journalists whose names they etch in a nearly exhaustive list of homaging. Congratulations to the writers for tearing through the Guardian imagination and situating the paper's rise from an initial glow to a more grandeur. Salute to them as well for forerunning some possible further expositions, not just for additional standpoints of the Guardian phenomenon, but for other authors to do the same with other institutions, all in the bid to stimulate understanding for the present and future. This is what the reviewer has asked me to read, and this is what I have read. And he asked me, I didn't add my own, I didn't subtract, I didn't add. Thank you very much.
Your Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo. I want to thank you, sir, for joining us again today. We recognize the fact that you had to come out of your very busy schedule to be part of today's occasion. So right about now, I think I need to specially thank Mr. Ibrahim Ogbodo, because if he were not the actual reviewer and he went on to do what he did just in a short notice, I think it deserves a special round of applause. Please, let's recognize him. Okay, so we would want to take another documentary, and the essence of this particular documentary is to sort of lay a background of those who were there at the very beginning. The flagship thing just come on board. Some people played very critical role, and it's important that we give those people special recognition. So a documentary has been put together, and I would want to crave your indulgence for us to just quickly watch that right now. Before we do that, please, I'd like to also recognize those who are on Zoom, because since morning they've joined us and they've been very steadfast. In fact, I hear that some governors are actually on Zoom right now. If you could just quickly show us those who are on Zoom. They've been on Zoom, they've been on YouTube, they've been on LinkedIn, they've joined on all the social media platform, and we recognize the fact that you've been part of this. Can we see them, or we should just go into the documentary? Okay, fantastic. So we'll just go ahead and watch the documentary right now before we go on to the next item. Thank you very much.
Mr. Alex Ibru was a very simple man, not complicated at all. He liked to keep to the rules in anything he did. Family life, friendship, business. Just a simple man, and that reflected even in the way he dressed. He was always in his white, simple, not very expensive material, well tailored, sat well on his body. He was that kind of man, just keep things simple.
When I left the civil service in 1979, Alex came up to me and said, we're going to start a new newspaper and I want your help. I want you to help in setting it up.
The Guardian idea was by him.
Don't forget, before the Guardian, there was the Daily Times.
He said his elder brother had a problem with the military after the coup that took away General Mohammed, and he was locked up. Mr. Ibru went around newspaper houses for the world to hear the family side, but no newspaper was ready to take their statement. Mr. Ibru was disappointed, and he made up his mind that they must also have their own newspaper.
And he said to me, look, for the next year, I'll take care of whatever you were getting from the Daily Times while you sort yourself out. I said, what? He said, yes, he will do that. I think I had about 2,500 naira in my account. I had 7 children and a wife, no house, nowhere to stay. So it was like a deliverer. God was saving me from problem through Alex.
Dr. Makibu started to assemble people. He got me, he got a man called Nikidue. They nominated me to be the editor, in charge of editorial board. I was in charge of editorial newsroom and all that, generally Nikidue production. I was also in charge of administration as well as advert, until we resumed at Wisdom House in 82.
I remember I actually used to cook and send to them, because they worked from morning till midnight, even till the next day. So I was the silent cook in the background, sending food to those pioneer staff. But they did a wonderful job. And I recall the old city was, sooner than later, you will read The Guardian.
The Guardian redefined Nigerian journalism as we knew before then. And then from out of nowhere, The Guardian came on board and then changed the way newspapers were produced in our country, and brought in some of us who came from academia and brought in some of the finest journalists, you know, people like Lade Bonola, Femi Kusa and co, who had come from also the Daily Times tradition, and then changed the perception completely.
Because we really had a flagship. What's a flagship? Discipline, integrity, and truthfulness. Alex never said, this is the kind of thing I want for editorial. No. This is the headline I want. No. You are the experts. Go ahead and do it.
If the government lays certain rules in terms of running your business, corporate governance, and stuff like that, he ensured we kept it to the letter.
The publisher and I did interviews with about 10, maybe 11 world leaders. We met with Nyerere, we met with Kenneth Kaunda, we interviewed Robert Mugabe, we did Omo Sankara together, we interviewed Shimon Peres of Israel together. He and I went to do the interview with Gaddafi. Well, if you're referring to the Crefour crisis, which was the first big crisis we had in 1984, the publisher was outstanding. He stood by the two journalists, Tunde Thompson and Dokoye Arabo, both in terms of making sure that their families didn't suffer when they were in detention.
Tunde Thompson was the foreign affairs land editor. Ndoka Arabo was news editor. So I myself, while they locked them up, I was also told to be reporting at Awolowo Road. I was reporting every morning. So we were jailed for publishing truth that embarrassed. And the company was fined 50,000 naira. 50,000 naira at that time.
And as a newspaper, conscience nurtured by truth. Don't say anything that is not true. Also, we have to be careful at every point in time not to allow the whatever to drive us. It has to be the truth. And for a man at that time to want the truth and the truth and the truth and the truth, that's very great.
He was a very private person. He was self-effacing. He didn't get involved with pushing himself around as publisher of The Guardian. He did things behind the scene quietly. And that's what he liked. That's the way he liked it. And that's the way he did it.
He never believed in borrowing. He never borrowed a dime until he left. You know, he was that kind of person. Very prudent. He worked hard, made his money, and he used it judiciously, you know.
To call him a special creation, to call him a man of honor, as a special creation, because he was so far, far, far ahead of his time. The most important things in life were the things that really mattered to him. To help others, integrity, to spend whatever he has or he had to really help the nation and whoever I knew.
Well, I just wish that there are many people like Alex. I think that for a young man, Alex became a millionaire at 29 or 30. He did it himself, you know, it was his own business.
Tremendous credit to Mrs. Maiden Ibru, who has kept the flag flying. I think Maiden is a remarkable lady, When something happened just before the publisher passed away, I went to see him a few days before he died. And he pulled me aside and said, please thank Maiden for me, for the things she has done and standing by me, being supportive of me so clearly. But more importantly is that Maiden has held on, you know, to the place and has kept the place going.
If he was to be alive, well, you know, we are now the Guardian Group. We've gone beyond the newspaper. So we are now, we're still the Guardian newspapers. We are Guardian TV. As part of the Guardian Group, I'm sure you are aware of Eyimofe, our very first movie we attempted. And it's been acknowledged by over 30 countries across the globe. When he was to die, of all days, he chose my birthday, November 20. So every November 20, it's mixed feelings, you know. It's my birthday, which is meant to be a happy day for me, but it also, all the memories just flood back to all those days and all those last few months of his life.
Flagship Trust Fund, Senator Ayogo Eze, to please come forward and talk briefly about the Trust Fund. Let's put hands together for him, please.
Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, I am also inclined to observe protocols already established, but I'm going to depart in one form. Gathered in this room are a few people, I believe, belong to what I might class as the pantheon of the Nigerian press. And it will be a disservice if I don't recognize them along with our vice president. And I'll start with the publisher, Mrs. Medin Ibru. I will also recognize Remo Shego Oshoba, His Excellency. I recognize Ambassador Dr. P.D. Cole. I recognize Lade Bonola. I recognize Dr. Yemi Ogunbiye. And importantly, recognize the Duke, Nduka Obaigbena, who has done for journalism a lot in this country and beyond. Well, I recognize everybody, but I think this is a journalism event, and I have to celebrate the journalists in our midst. Well, I don't want Martin Oloja to go and write editorial because he's looking at me, our editor-in-chief. Please, I recognize you. Your Excellency, the first thing I need to do is to join everybody to congratulate these two young men. Well, young, really. Who put the book together that has brought all of us here. But there are a lot of other things that have happened in the process of bringing everybody together and trying to write a book. In that process, we've been able to bring back over 300 people who worked in The Guardian in those days onto a particular platform. And arising from the interactions on that platform, We have brought up a board of trustees that has raised some funds through some members and some good spirited individuals in Nigeria to help in the interim the less privileged in our midst. Some of our colleagues who are sick, who are not able to help themselves, who are living in conditions that we think shouldn't be, but who could otherwise get help. And we've been able to reach out to quite a number of them, get a kidney transplant, get dialysis here, get one medical effort sorted out or the other. And we've been onto it, tagging along, trying to help with whatever we can. I believe that the reason why they asked me to speak is because this masquerade that is dancing in-house will someday want to dance on the national stage. We have always spoken about wanting to do some good works that will impact our nation in the area of trying to help change some narratives and institute conversations that will build peace, that will build understanding and build brotherhood, that will cooperate with our government and make sure that we are a nation with national ethos, with common nationalism. And that is a job that I think that Mr. Vice President here will be called upon sometime in the future to come and do with us, because it's a job that will speak to his responsibility as enshrined in Section 14, Subsection 2B of the Constitution of the Federal Republic, that the security and welfare of the people shall be the primary purpose of governance. And if all of us reach out to help one another, we will be able to squelch insurgency, banditry, and all sorts of uprising and contestations. Those things are coming up because of want, because of poverty, because of people feeling that they've been left out of the loop. And I believe that we have a responsibility as individuals within our society to lend a helping hand. It is not something that should be left for the government alone. We all together can work on this through contributions, through personal effort, to make sure that we reclaim our country, because this is our country. No matter what happens, there's no other place you go and you get a welcome like you get here. So I believe that we have a role to play. And you can see that even globally, there's always a relationship between philanthropy and business. When you finish and you become successful, the next thing is to set up a philanthropy to reach out to society, to make sure, first of all, you start with your corporate social responsibility, to quench restlessness around where you're doing your business. Then you set up your foundation. Bill and Melinda Gates, Ford Foundation, Kellogg Foundation, and the most popular of all of them, Nobel Foundation, the Nobel Peace Foundation, that is one of the most prestigious. Even locally here, Dangote, Bua, and others are already beginning to set up foundations. So I believe that it is something on the right path that we should all be able to tune our minds when we are called upon to do something, especially within the media industry. So I'm challenging all other media organizations to emulate what The Guardian has done. Come together, write your book, come together, put up a foundation, support the management of The Guardian and other people of your organization to make sure that the welfare of your people are taken care of. Your Excellency, Mr. President, I'm sure that we don't want to bore you with a long speech, but I'm sure that at the appropriate time, we are going to invite you to come with us on this project. God bless you all.
Thank you very much, Senator Ayogweze. We are indeed grateful for the initiative. And we also thank all of those who are joining with you to run this process. Now, we shared a documentary before now, even before His Excellency the Vice President joined us, on the person of Mr. Alex Ibru. And a while ago, we also shared the other one on the birth of The Guardian, apart from what we also enjoyed listening to Chief Oshoba. We thank you all very much, most distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. In a moment, we shall be inviting His Excellency the Vice President and the Chairman of this event for a special recognition award. But before then, may I crave indulgence of one and all, because we're here to honor Mr. Alex Ibru and all of those who have contributed one way or the other to set the flagship asail. Most of them, some of them are not here with us anymore, and so I'll crave your indulgence for us to rise for a minute's silence in honor of the memory of Mr. Alex Ibru and all of those who were part of the process of The Guardian, but are no longer with us. May the souls of the faithful departed rest in perfect peace. Thank you all very much. We may resume our seats. Thank you, Mr. Vice. One and all. I know it's not time for the vote of thanks. Sean will be coming up later to do that. But meanwhile, there's a special recognition award for Mr. Alex Ibru. And may I crave the indulgence of our chairman, Aremo Segun Oshoba, to please step forth as we invite also Lady Maiden Ibru to receive the award on behalf of Alex Ibru. I want to believe that Mr. Chairman, sir, we should also invite the Vice President up. Okay. And also invite His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Please, let's put our hands together as they walk up the stage for this special recognition award. Thank you.
Vice President is our leader here, and I leave everything to Professor Yemi Osinbajo, His Excellency the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, to do all the presentation and cut the tape. Mr. Vice President, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much. Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it is my special privilege and honor to present this certificate of distinction posthumously to Mr. Alexander Uruemu Ibru in recognition of the exceptional and exemplary newspaper proprietorship and entrepreneurial acumen in founding the flagship, The Guardian, to his wife, Lady Maiden Alex Ibru, the custodian of The Guardian legacy. And this is presented to Mr. Alexander Uruemu Ibru posthumously for his exemplary acumen in founding the flagship, The Guardian. And this is from the flagship publishers.
Congratulations. Thank you very much.
Now I invite Mr. Vice President to now formally. After his speech, he will do the cutting of the tape. Thank you very much, Mr. Vice President.
May we now invite Lady Maiden Ibru. So please, we shall invite Your Excellency, the Vice President, upstate later. I know that protocol demands that once you step up here, you get it done once and for all. But thank you for bearing with us. I wish to now invite Lady Maiden Alex Ibru for some remarks. Let's put our hands together for her. Thank you. Thank you.
Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, representatives of the governors, the Guardian Rutam House family present, members of the flagship ensemble, former associates of the Guardian, and of course members of the larger Ibru family. I would like to thank God for making this day a reality. This is indeed the day that the Lord has made, and we should rejoice and be glad in it. I am happy I'm alive to witness an honor done to the memory of my beloved late husband. Mr. Alexander Uruemu Ibru had laurels bestowed upon him from the University of Port Harcourt. So many accolades for his business acumen and support for democracy and good governance. I hope people will remember that he quietly supported the pioneer campaign for democracy, groups, civil liberty organizations in the country in the 90s, among other development and philanthropic organizations. But I am persuaded that this monument, a solid book, unsolicited in honor of his memory, is considered invaluable to the family. The the reason. The place of Alex Ibru as one of the foremost makers of the Nigerian print media has not been properly documented. Thank God, at last, here we are. I would like to pay tribute to the two former associates, reporters of the Guardian newspaper, Mr. Seun Ogun Seyintan and Aaron Okodie, who looked into the seeds of times and came up with the idea that we are launching today. It's an idea whose time has come. I know it's the Lord's doing, and so it's marvelous in our eyes. Specifically, on behalf of the Ibru family, I say a big thank you to two significant former reporters who had assembled all the great makers of the Guardian Nigeria, completed the manuscript before sending a copy to us for launch protocol. In other words, let me state in all modesty that we did not commission the book. It is an independent project by these two great thinkers. You have honored the memory of my husband. The God of all creation will honor you by his great powers too. In the same vein, I want to use this rare opportunity of the book presentation to acknowledge some of the great friends of my husband who assisted him in no small way measure to lay a very solid foundation for the building of this great newspaper. The Guardian. In Nigeria, two of them are here today. Dr. Patrick Delecole is actually a godfather of one of the kids, and Aremo Olusegun Oshoba, another godfather of one of the kids. Don't ask me which of them, the days have gone by. Yes, Aremo Oshoba, a former governor of Ogun State, would have been the pioneer managing director of The Guardian, but for the political actors who outsmarted us then by recruiting him to be the chief executive of another newspaper, I remember it was the Herald. I would like young Nigerians, and indeed journalists, to note that Dr. Cole, a former managing director of Daily Times, actually attracted the late Stanley Makebu and the late Mr. Delegiwa back to the country. First to the Daily Times, where Dr. Cole set up the first ever editorial board in the Nigerian print media. The pioneer chairman of the editorial board of Daily Times then was Dr. Makebu, who was to later become first executive editor of The Guardian in 1983, thanks to the effort of Dr. Cole. That was how Mr. Lade Bonwola Ladbone of the then Daily Times as chief quality control officer, chief sub-editor, was also brought in as first associate editor of The Guardian. He, Bonwola, was later sworn in as the first editor of The Guardian Daily. All of these great destiny shapers who were with my late husband are still with me today. Thank you very much. I want to pay glowing tribute to them. Aremo Oshoba, Dr. Cole, Mr. Lade Bonwola, who is still writing a shadowy weekly column for The Guardian, Dr. Cole, Nigeria's former ambassador to Brazil, remains a visiting consultant to the editorial board of The Guardian, chaired by a former vice chancellor of Obafemi Awolowo University, Ileife, Professor Wale Omoli, another friend of my late husband. Professor Mole, too, has been a strong pillar on the board of the newspaper. Note that I am already leading us into inner circle of the Guardian intellectual cabal, responsible for the quality of the editorials you read every day. Professor Bolaji Akinyemi, a former Nigerian Minister of Foreign Affairs, unfortunately is not able to be here with us today, is also a visiting consultant to the editorial board. Same for retired Lieutenant General Chris Ali, a former Chief of Army Staff Nigeria, author of a classic Federal Republic of the Nigerian Army, who is also a visiting consultant to the editorial board. It is incredible that these great friends of my darling husband come physically to the editorial board every Wednesday. Ambassador Ahmadu Hamza too was visiting, even all the way from Sokoto, until he died a few years ago. May his soul rest in perfect peace. There are all the young professors who are visiting members of the editorial board, including Professor Sylvester Akhaini, former head of the Department of Political Science, Lagos State University, Professor Undubisi Unwokoma, Director, Center for Economic Policy Analysis and Research, University of Lagos, Professor Abigail Owezi Undisika, she's actually in the house, I saw her earlier on, former head of Department of Mass Communication, University of Lagos, Professor Jide Jimo of the School of Communication, Lagos State University. There are directors of the company who are also members. My dear brother, Dr. Alexander Tomopoulos, a US-trained technocrat and environmental scientist. Mr. Toke Alex Ibru, my son, London and US-trained business executive and executive director, leading the multimedia company. Other significant members are Dr. Tony Okeregbe, former associate of The Guardian, now of Philosophy Department, University of Lagos. Is also chief special essayist. There is Dr. Oju Ogunbunka, former executive secretary, Chartered Institute of Bankers. Other strong intellectuals and technocrats on the editorial board include Mr. Adaibofua Ojomaikri, an economist who retired as a senior civil servant. He is Adam Smith in the house. There is also Mr. Francis Onayeka, a senior journalist, management consultant, motivational speaker, and life coach. His problem is that he has too many classical books. In the house too, we have Dr. Onyeka Keya, a widely traveled scholar on geography, urban, and regional planning. Mr. Kunle Sonwolu, a former editor of The Guardian on Sunday, who is now our editorial page editor. Dr. Wole Oyebade, who in 2019 was honored by the University of Lagos for writing the best doctoral thesis in the Faculty of Arts, is one of our in-house special essayists. Mr. Efeturi Ojona, a lawyer, is the general manager, corporate advisory and legal services. And of course, Mr. Martins Oloja, former editor of The Guardian, a resourceful and award-winning reporter, writer, editorialist, and columnist, now our editor-in-chief, are members of the board. These are the powers behind the editorial board of The Guardian. Please give them a round of applause. We are highly honored the Vice President made time to be with us today. As we are all aware, the President is out of the country. In fact, we had to sort of change the date because he really was very, very keen to be with us. And of course, on Wednesday, you know they have their usual Federal Executive Council meeting. So Wednesday wouldn't have been a good day. It would have been just too much on him. And that's why I'm sure some of you are aware we changed it for today. Yeah, so we thank you, Mr. Vice President, for your time and love for family. And God bless you and safe trip, sir. Yes. I would like to reiterate a few spots, points we have repeatedly made in some of our editorials. Now this is for you, Mr. VP. First, we would like the president and his men and women to note that restructuring of the federation in the context of federalism is an idea whose time has come, and no politics can repel that idea. That is why we have been committed to a weekly commentary on the front page of The Guardian on the issue. We do this every Thursday. As you may have seen, today is the 24th edition of our Federalism is the Answer After All serial. We would like our president to know that a return to true federalism will solve most of our security and economic challenges. It is not new. The issue of restructuring is one of the promises that the administration of President Buhari hasn't kept. It is part of the APC manifesto, and there is a report of the El-Rufai committee that the party received since 2018. There have been many more reports on this, including a 2014 report on restructuring from the political conference during the Jonathan administration, which he handed over to President Buhari. We are also aware of other challenges, including rampaging corruption at all levels. We know about the debt burden and ticklish but controversial fuel subsidy that have always made nonsense of our budget expectations. There are many more, including healthcare infrastructure challenges, but the most urgent issue our leader should address at this time is nation building. We didn't know the implication of what iconic Chinua Achebe, a professor, was saying when he wrote in his last classic, "There Was a Country." Most people are quite fearful now that Nigeria is too divided to survive as a country. Only very few people believe in one Nigeria at this moment. We have Eastern Nigeria, Western Nigeria, Far Northern Nigeria, North Central Nigeria, Middle Delta Nigeria, Niger Delta Nigeria, etc. There is therefore a crisis of coherence at the moment, as the late Dr. Makebu once wrote. What is worse, there have been serious allegations of Northernization and Islamization as a fundamental objective and directive principle of state policy. These are signs of a sinking state. I believe the leader of the most populous black nation on earth should at this time demonstrate to all of us that he indeed belongs to nobody. He had a covenant with us when he told us on May 29, 2015, "I belong to everybody, I belong to nobody." Is that not correct? Yes. Thank you. Today, not many people believe that our leader has fought a good fight for national cohesion. His appointments, including another one he made on Tuesday in the security sector, hasn't shown us that he indeed belongs to everybody. Our leader should therefore be the father of the nation at this time. Finally, on behalf of Newspaper Proprietors Association of Nigeria, NPAN, I would like to appeal that there should be a stimulus package for us in form of tax holidays and duty-free package for newsprint we import for our publication. It hasn't been easy for all of us. Newsprint, the most expensive raw material for printing newspapers, are imported from Europe. The implication is fast killing the newspaper industry. We appeal for relief package in this area. I want to announce to you too that The Guardian, our Guardian, is also restructuring into a multimedia company. You will read the details in the New Deal, which will make the newspaper and other subsidiaries very competitive. In fact, our first movie Eyi mo fe means this is my desire. Eyi mo fe is actually a Shekiri name, just by coincidence. I had nothing to do with this. And it's been acknowledged across the globe. And next, I think it's Sunday the 18th, we're going to have the premiere here in Lagos. We went to Berlin, where it was actually viewed. And my God, the theater could sit about 800 people. And for the 3 days we were there, the theater was packed full. So it's a movie you guys should see. A very small story. Nigerians want a decent life. It's not happening. They now want to go through the Mediterranean. In the process, some of them get killed, you know, they drown, and then they return back. But these two people decided, you know what? At the end of day, home is home. And so we're not going anywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you very much for joining us on this occasion. Thank you. God bless.
Thank you very much. Please, another round of applause for Lady Made in Ibru.
Thank you.
She has also deployed the art of editorializing. Thank you. We're indeed grateful, ma'am, for keeping the flagship flying. At this point, Mr. Chairman, most distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, your excellencies, it gives me special pleasure and honor to invite His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, DCON, for his remarks and the formal presentation of the publication. Mr. Vice President, sir.
Thank you very much. Please sit. The chairman of the occasion, Aremo Olusegun Oshoba, former governor of Ogun State. His Excellency Donald Duke, former governor of Cross River State. The chairperson, publisher, and chief executive officer of the Guardian Group, Lady Maiden Alex Ibru. Professor Wale Omole, chair of the editorial board of the Guardian. Mr. Nduka Obaigbena, publisher of this day newspapers, the Oba of Igbomina, Ekiti, His Royal Highness Oba Rufus Olanrewaju Ajayi, members of the Ibru family present, management and staff of the Guardian newspapers, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen. It really is a delight to be part of this unveiling of a chapter of our history. A story that has not been told in full until now, the story of the Guardian newspapers. And this story is significant because the Guardian newspapers have redefined print media in Nigeria, and also for its uniqueness in bringing public intellectuals and academics into journalism and breeding a generation of talented journalists. But to grasp the significance of the Guardian, it's important to situate its odyssey within the larger Nigerian story, and particularly in the context of the evolution of the fourth estate in our country. The Nigeria press has deep roots going back almost 150 years. Indeed, the Nigeria press came into existence before Nigeria itself and was instrumental to the birthing of this nation. So it's no surprise that several luminaries of the anti-colonial and nationalist movement were also leading figures in the press. Nnamdi Azikiwe, Ernest Okoli, Anthonia Nahoro, Herbert Macaulay, all venerable figures in our pantheon of nationalist icons, first established themselves as journalists of repute. It was then emerging as the most vibrant and dynamic press in Africa. So given its origins as the fulcrum of the nationalist struggle, it's not surprising that the relational dynamic between the Nigerian press and the Nigerian state was always largely hostile and adversarial, especially in the years after we gained independence from the British. This dynamic was accentuated by the succession of military dictatorships that seized power following the collapse of the First Republic in 1966. Since military rule is characterized chiefly by the abbreviation of civil liberties, the shrinking of civic spaces, and the imposition of constraints on the freedom of expression, it was only logical for the press to find itself on the opposite side of a confrontation with the military regimes of that era. The peak of the tensions between the press and the military in the 1970s was the nationalization of the Daily Times. So it was in this illiberal and censorial climate that The Guardian was born. So right from its first edition on February 27, 1983, The Guardian carved a niche for itself with a distinctive and sophisticated editorial style, linguistic elegance, good prose, and high-quality print standards. Its mode of engagement was even-tempered, demonstrated in the deliberate moderation and thoughtfulness in its headlines and captions. Most of us will remember the news stories of the alleged death then of the great Zeke in 1989. Many newspapers ran screaming headlines, "Zeke is dead. The great Owele of Onitsha passes on. Nigeria's first president dies." Some even reported the formation of a national burial committee. We all reached for The Guardian, whose headlines, in typical Guardianese, was simply, quote, "Zeke dead, alive, jubilation, Nsukka," end of quote. Today, Pride, a young journalist then, who is now, I believe, Dr. Pride, had taken the trouble of investigating the story with a visit to Chief Adeniran Ogunsanya, a longtime friend and confidant of Zeke, who said that he had just spoken to Zeke and that Zeke was well alive. As it turned out, the great Zeke was not only alive and well, but lived another 7 years thereafter. Unfortunately, the gentleman who was touted as the burial committee chairman in some news reports passed on even well ahead of the great Zeke. The Guardian set itself apart as an outpost of liberalism, populated by intrepid journalists and keen-minded intellectuals devoted to freedom of thought and inquiry. Its op-ed pages very quickly became the arena of choice for the defining public debates of the day. The media landscape of the 1980s was not bereft of idealists and ideologues and intellectuals with visions of remaking society. What was unique about The Guardian was that it represented a rare but potent combination of an abundance of ideas and a wealth of resources. It was a happy marriage of socially conscious intellection and missionary capital. In other words, there was a cast of insightful thinkers with a profound understanding of the Nigerian media landscape who were eager to make a change. But the change could not have happened without an entrepreneur who shared that vision and a co-visioner, Chief Olusegun Osogbo. While Dr. Stanley Makibo, Dr. Patrick Dele Cole, Mr. Lade Bonola, Mr. Femi Kusa, Dr. Eddie Raw, later joined by Dr. Yemi Ogunbi and Mr. Nick Ndue, formed that core team of thinkers behind The Guardian. Mr. Alex Ibru was that visionary investor who was courageous enough to trust the thinkers, to find a businessman that could trust a group of intellectuals with editorial freedom in the treacherous socio-political climate of the time, as Alex Ibru did, was clearly exceptional. His calm deportment belied his understanding of the terrain, his foresight, and his propensity for risk-taking. He truly typified the idea of the capitalist driven by conscience. His courage of conviction, exemplified in the actualization of the Guardian, will remain indelible. I've dwelt a bit on the nature of this partnership between people of means and people of ideas that gave us the Guardian, because I believe that is a sort of transformative synergy that we need to see more often, especially in order to drive our quest for a better society. We need such partnerships across the broad spectrum of civil society and the private sector. The Guardian harked back to the proud and illustrious tradition of the Nigerian press that practiced journalism with a social mission and a commitment to speaking truth to power. It played an important role in the struggles that birthed our democracy, suffering proscription and the firebombing of his business offices at Rutham House. Alex Ibru himself narrowly survived an assassination attempt in which he was severely injured. Years later, I confronted the horror of that attack on him myself when, as Attorney General here in Lagos, it was my lot to prosecute his assailants. It was a reflection of the terrible costs that journalists bore as they continued to heroically ply their craft as an act of resistance against tyranny of any sort. For decades, the men and women that work at The Guardian have drawn inspiration from the immortal words of Uthman Damfodio on its masthead: conscience is an open wound, only the truth can heal it. It is the role of journalists to tell the truth, even when it is inconvenient. This mission has a special resonance in this day and age. Even as we strive to make governance more transparent and accountable in its workings, and to abandon the habits of secrecy and opacity that became deeply ingrained during the era of military rule. We have realized, though, that the abuse of state power is not the only threat to the liberal tradition. Right now, we also have to deal with issues such as the proliferation of fake news. Almost daily, fake news or mischievously manipulated news is trafficked with a clear intent of warping the perception of reality and inducing conflict. It is said that journalism is the first rough draft of history. It is true that reportage shapes the perception and understanding of events. It shapes the memories and can even influence behavior, for good or for ill. There are arguably no bigger influencers than those who report and interpret the world to us. This is considerable power, and it comes with responsibility. About four decades ago, The Guardian set new standards that forever transformed the practice of journalism. Today, a more complex media and information landscape requires a core of professionals to set new standards and to raise the quality of the fare that is on offer. The pioneers of The Guardian understood that journalism operates in a social context and cannot be value neutral. The same cognitive commitment is incumbent upon all media practitioners today. We are at a time in our national odyssey in which retailers of discord and merchants of strife are working assiduously against our collective potential as a people. Creating a commonality of purpose in an ethnically and culturally diverse society is challenging the world over. However, nation building is not the sole preserve of politicians and governments. In fact, it is just as much a task for civil society, of which the press is an important member. It is true that freedom of expression is enshrined in our constitution, but we all agree that society, progress, and order depend upon the responsible exercise of freedom. Otherwise, the end result will be anarchy. So as we struggle to build our nation with the bricks of mutuality and plurality and tolerance, I would suggest that those of us that stand as the gatekeepers in the fourth estate must demonstrate a greater awareness of the sensibilities and sensitivities of our society. I think in sum, what the Guardian has embodied in these past years is a fidelity to the principle of balance, of objectivity and fair hearing, not only as a corporate culture, but also as a moral obligation to the larger society. That insistence by the gatekeeper that leads are well investigated and reports are well researched before the copy is passed on for publication. The restraint to leave out a claim when in doubt. In summary, what in my humble view pre-qualifies a newspaper to become a true marketplace of ideas, or what the great American playwright Arthur Miller had in mind when he said, and I quote, "A good newspaper is a nation talking to itself," end of quote. I think time and time again, The Guardian has shown that it is possible to be critical without being destructive, to be constructive and not be compromised. Perhaps what I like most about the book is that it's a mosaic of memories by different generations of The Guardian. It's also a reminder of just how many journalists pass through the paper during the course of their careers. The Guardian is no longer just a newspaper house, but a public institution, one that has served as an exemplar and a model for generations of media practitioners who replicates its ethos and standards in different ways. So by documenting the rise of The Guardian, Aaron Okodie and Oseun Ogunseyitan have additionally reminded us, particularly of how the present can be shaped by the past, but perhaps more importantly, what has been done merely reveals what more can be done. We all must commend the authors and the Guardian newspapers, and especially the chief custodian of the legacy, Lady Maiden Alex Ibru, for broadening our understanding of history, for the appreciation of the present and the inspiration of the future. I wish you very many more successes in the years ahead. It is now my very special pleasure to formally, I believe I will not be doing it alone.
No, sir. We also wish to invite our chairman and also Lady Maiden Ibru, and invite the representatives of the governors, Professor Wole Omole, to also join along with His Excellency the Vice President. We'd also invite Dr. Yemi Ogunbiyi, Mr. Donald Duke, Ambassador Dele Cole, Olorogu Ibru, Uncle Sumi Smart Cole, please. Uncle Sumi Smart Cole, please. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, no, please, sir. Just today, sir. Thank you very much, sir. It's easy. Please. Mr. Lade Bonwola, Uncle Ladbone, please. Just hold on.
Excellencies, our very distinguished and honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's now my very special pleasure and privilege to formally present The Making of the Nigerian Flagship, the story of The Guardian, for the benefit of the Nigerian public and
the international public and to the glory of God.
Spread out and have the photo opportunity. Thank you. Just move on. And Ogushe, Aaron, you are there. Thank you very much. Yes. We've passed round purchase card, 25,000 for the hardback. Arabo himself. That we can have good copies later tomorrow. 25,000 naira for hard cover and 15,000 naira for the paperback edition. So we have passed around the purchase card. I hope we are good enough now. Thank you very much, Your Excellency, the Vice President. We are indeed very grateful for this honor. Please, let's create the pathway there. We'll have copies of the publication. We'll get the authors to autograph copies for us, those of us who are privileged to be here today at the formal presentation. We thank all of those who have joined along with us to mark today. Thank you very much. Please, if we did not recognize you, please forgive us. We also wish to recognize by Zoom His Excellency the Governor of Kwara State, who is one of our co-hosts, has been most supportive, and we thank you very much, Your Excellency Abdurrahman Abdurrazak. We are indeed thankful. The representative of the EFCC chairman is also here, Ibrahim Shazali. Thank you also for obliging us with your presence. Let's keep our applause going for His Excellency the Vice President. Thank you very much, sir. Before we call for the national anthem, may I... Uncle Sumi, thank you very much. We are indeed thankful. So we have passed around copies such as this purchase card. So our ushers go around and pick up copies. Shehun Ogushoito, please. Vote of thanks before the national anthem. Shehun.
Your Excellency, the Vice President, Professor Yemi Oshibajo. Mine will be short. The day is far gone. We just want to say thank you, sirs and mirs. May the Almighty God that has decided to choose this day to honor our publisher that we 400 strong foundation members of the Guardian founding team believe is under celebrated. May God honor us all. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much. While we remain standing, please, the national anthem. Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. We are grateful, Governors of Sokoto, Ekiti, Kwara, Enugu, Delta, and Lagos State for your support, particularly so Delta State for co-hosting and Kwara State for co-hosting. There's a performance that would have as we round up this event. We invite Efa Onibata, yeah, the wonderful lady, to step forth again. Thank you. Especially thank the Enugu State Government who have supported this process with 2 million naira. We thank you very much, my brother, for representing us so very cordially. We are indeed grateful. We are indeed grateful.
fire, wa se bo si loya. E fire, wa se bo si loya. E fire, wa se bo si loya. E fire, wa se bo si loya. A se se de osu, a para binti. E fire, wa se bo si loya.
I'm
abale fe gbo ese o
Shed us a big game.